cancer of the cervix and radiation. This is one of a series of cancer videos found on the website aboutcancer.com. This will explore the role of radiation in the treatment of cervix cancer. As noted here, cervix cancer is one of the less common malignancies. Uterine cancer is now more common, as is ovary. The age of cervix cancer is tend to be younger, 49 years compared to uterus cancer, which is 61. The lifetime risk of getting this cancer is less than 1%. About half the patients are diagnosed at an earlier local stage, and as noted, the 5-year survival is very good. Patients who have more advanced cancer, as noted, their survival is lower. According to the National Cancer Institute, there are 3 things people can do to lower their risk of this cancer. First, avoid the risk of a HPV, human papillomas virus infection. So abstinence or condoms, or now HPV vaccination, usually at the age of 12, is very good advice. Screening with pap smears has been shown to lower the incidence of mortality by 80%, so regular pap smears and gynecologic exams are useful. And smoking cessation is good advice. Women who smoke have a 2 or 3 times higher risk of getting cervix cancer, particularly if they have an HPV infection. The importance of screening is shown here because the cancer tends to progress slowly, actually over a number of years from the earliest stage, dysplasia or in situ, to early stage 1 and then more advanced cancer, and then finally getting into the tissue around the uterus called the perimetrium, or spreading down into the vagina. The workup for cervix cancer generally would start with a biopsy and a review of the pathology. Many of the patients may benefit from a CAT scan or a PET scan or an MRI to help stage the extent of the cancer. The pathology report is based on a proper biopsy of the cervix. The pathology report will show whether the cancer is invasive or just an earlier stage, such as dysplasia or in situ. There are 2 common types of cancer. Most women have squamous cancer, but adenocarcinoma is becoming a bit more common. And the pathology report will demonstrate the depth of invasion and the lateral spread of the cancer. This is important for staging, as noted in a moment. The staging of cervix cancer, again, is related to the spread and the size. The earliest stage 1 is cancer confined to the cervix. 1A is too small to see and 1B is visible. And the size, as noted here, impacts the stage. Stage 2 is somewhere beyond the cervix, just into the upper vagina for stage 2A, or the side area called the perimetrium for stage 2B. Stage 3 is even more extensive. Stage 3A is all the way down to the lower third of the vagina, and stage 3B all the way to the pelvic sidewall or involving lymph nodes. Stage 4A is extending into the bladder or rectum, and stage 4B would be distant metastases. The anatomy of the pelvis is shown here, a so-called cross-sectional anatomy, just to show again how close the uterus and cervix sits between the bladder and the rectum, and a similar cross-sectional view showing how close the vagina and the rectum sit together. This would be a PET scan showing the area of the cervix. A PET scan will change colors if there's active cancer in the area and shows bright yellow on this picture right behind the bladder. PET scans are particularly helpful to look at lymph node spread. Cervix cancer can spread to the lymph nodes both in the pelvic lymph nodes and the area higher up called the para-aortic lymph nodes. And this is easy to see on a PET scan. The odds of lymph nodes can be 20% or 30% or even higher depending on the stage of the cancer in the cervix. And here's an example of the PET scan showing both pelvic lymph nodes and para-aortic lymph node spread. They appear yellow on these images. A similar internal view or cross-sectional view showing a para-aortic lymph node in yellow right between the kidneys in the middle of the abdomen, and a similar PET showing both pelvic and periaortic lymph nodes from cervix cancer. This would make the patient stage 3B. The survival by stage is shown here. Again, stage 1 and 2 is favorable, but the more advanced stages, the survival falls dramatically. And more detailed survival by stage is shown here. The best advice on treatment of cervix cancer, like most cancers, can be found on the website of the National Comprehensive Cancer Network. This can be accessed at nccn.org, and patients are encouraged to either review this or ask their doctor to review the current NCCN treatment guidelines with them. Basically, the guidelines would recommend for early stage patients, surgery is often the best, but radiation can be used even in early stages. More advanced stages are generally treated with radiation with or without chemotherapy. So again, with the earliest stages, hysterectomy, usually a radical hysterectomy with lymph node dissection, is the standard. Pelvic radiation is an option, but may have more sexual side effects. For the more advanced stages, pelvic radiation with or without chemo is generally favored over surgery. But surgery is still an option in these stages. If surgery is performed, postoperative radiation is sometimes necessary. If the pathology report shows that the cancer has spread to lymph nodes, if the patient has positive surgical margins or edges, if there's invasion into the perimetrium, which is the area on the side of the uterus, or other high-risk features are noted. And finally, the most advanced stages are generally now treated with pelvic radiation combined with chemotherapy, usually the drug cisplatin. There were a series of trials at the change of the millennium that showed survival advantage by combining chemotherapy with radiation, as noted here in 5 of the large trials that were published about that time. Radiation can be either external beam radiation, basically coming from the outside in, usually with a linear accelerator or perhaps a tomotherapy, or internal radiation, which is radiation that's given from the inside out, usually applicators or sources that are slid into the uterus or the vagina. If external radiation is planned, the first step is called simulation. A CAT scan is obtained. The CAT scan images are then imported into a computer and often merged with a PET scan or an MRI in order to determine a target for the radiation. There are standard areas that can be focused on. During the treatment, lasers will be used to line up the beam. External beam radiation is usually given 5 days a week, Monday through Friday. The treatments generally take 5 to 10 minutes. The radiologist will demonstrate the different organs. This is shown on a CAT scan. The bladder, the bowel, the rectum, other structures that need to be protected. And this is a similar view using an MRI. Again, the radiologist can define the cervix, the uterus, the rectum, the vagina, and make sure these areas are marked on the computer plan in order to avoid side effects. And then a computer-generated target, this is shown here in blue. The radiation cloud in blue is surrounding the pelvis, pelvic lymph nodes, para-aortic lymph nodes. And yet by using a tomotherapy, it was possible to avoid the liver and the spinal cord and the vertebrae. This would be a tomotherapy device, which includes a linear accelerator inside a CAT scan, and this can be very helpful for so-called image-guided IMRT. The standard technique for radiation is either external beam 5 days a week, and often internal radiation, either low-dose radiation, where the patient stays overnight in the hospital for 2 or 3 days, with a radium or cesium implant, and more modernly now, high dose rate, HDR, with a device that uses radioactive iridium. This is generally given as an outpatient, once a week for 3 to 5 weeks. The standard technique for internal radiation puts applicators inside the uterus or vagina. The dose has now been well established. The external beam dose is usually 45 gray. And the internal dose, or HDR dose, is usually 30 or 40 gray. And these are added up to get a total dose to the so-called point A area of 80 or 85 gray. The internal radiation devices, there are many different types that slide into the uterus or the vagina. The standard devices that were used in the past are shown here, a tandem that slid into the uterus, and so-called ovoids that sat into the vagina, or the lateral area of the vagina called the fornices. These were the typical radium or cesium applicators that were used in the past. This would be called low dose rate. Again, most women now would be treated with high dose rate, a device like the Nucleotron, where radioactive iridium is inside the device in basically a wire. The applicators are hollow and are inserted into the cervix or uterus or vagina. These can then be attached to the high dose rate machine. This would be a typical vaginal cylinder, and the radioactive wire basically sticks out the backside of this applicator. After this is inserted into the patient, the radioactive wire is attached to the tube, and the patient is laying on the table. The high dose rate machine will then basically insert the iridium into the tube inside the applicator inside the woman for about 5 minutes, and then the applicator would be removed. Side effects of radiation depend on the areas treated. If the periaortic lymph nodes higher in the abdomen are included, there'll be more side effects than if only a pelvic field is used. The side effects obviously are related to organs that are nearby. On this PET-CT scan, the cancer shows up in yellow, and you can see how close the small intestine is to the cancer on the upper image, and how close the bladder and rectum are in the lower image. Here's a typical anatomy image showing the structures that are in the radiation target area. The small bowel and colon can be affected, so bowel irritation. The ovaries and uterus can be affected, so issues related to fertility, menopause, or hormone changes need to be considered. The bladder and rectum can be irritated, so urinary symptoms, and even the bones in the pelvis or femurs can be affected, and radiation can affect the bone. The pelvic field most commonly would affect the bowel, so diarrhea, cramps, frequency of bowel movements, loss of appetite, fatigue are all common. On the side view, again, it's a reminder how close the radiation would be to the rectum, bladder, and vagina. So urinary burning, frequency, vaginal irritation are all common side effects. Long-term side effects, any of these organs can be affected. There's a small risk of chronic bowel irritation, bleeding or looseness, bladder irritation, sexual dysfunction with more dryness or fibrosis or narrowness of the vaginal vault. Ovarian function, as noted, can be affected, and usually menopause is caused. And even osteitis, the bones may be more brittle after pelvic radiation. All the details of both side effects, treatment protocols, and outcome can be found on the website aboutcancer.com.